Today is the 12th of February, 2013. We are here at the Political Science Institute of Free University. And I'm talking to Mr. Japheth Omojuwa from Nigeria, who is one of the best-known political bloggers and the editor of africanliberty.org. Japheth, you are currently on a tour which brings you from Africa to Europe, to the USA and back. Can you tell us more about it? Why are you doing this and what are you doing?
My different stops in the different places have different objectives. In the UK, it's about the big picture of Nigeria. It's UK trade and investment, green technology show. So for me, my presence is just to talk to people about Nigeria and how they can invest in the green energy, alternative energy, and sustainable development, and all of those technological issues with respect to Nigeria. In Berlin, where we are at the moment and where I'm excited to be, I'm speaking about the Occupy movement in Nigeria. I'm speaking about the new awakening in Nigeria, where young people in Nigeria are raising their voices against bad governance. They are raising their voices against corruption. They are raising their voices against oppression. And they are trying to get in the order of their own future. They are trying to get their destiny in their hands and influence not just today's politics, but politics tomorrow with respect to the 2015 elections and all that. I'm going back to the UK from here to continue the UK trade and investment roadshow. And after that, I'm in Washington to attend the Students for Liberty conference and also get to talk about what I have been doing on social media with Occupy Nigeria in the past and the projects like Save Bagega. And then after that, to New York to meet with fellow Nigerian organizers who are based in the United States. And then after that, I'm in Lagos for the Social Media Week in Lagos. It's a global event. I'll be making my own contributions virtually from the United States, and then I'll be there physically on the 23rd. And then the last leg of the tour is going back home in Abuja on the 27th to attend a British Council's sponsored event. And then after that, I'll look back and see what I could have done better.
You referred to yourself mainly as a blogger. Is that a real job?
Yeah, that's not a real job. A real job depends on what your box is, what the box in your head is. When I was growing up in Nigeria, a real job was doctors, things like being a doctor, being a lawyer, being an accountant maybe, and you know, those things, the box was small. Then after that, some young people started doing jobs that were not real, like photography, people like Kelechi Amadi, Obisomto even is representing our generation very well, like makeup artists, people like Feladru Toye. So later, people added those jobs to the real jobs. So today, blogging is not a real job. Even President Obasanjo told me today that that's not a job. And I mean, I accepted it because people of his age and generation have a box in their head of what a job is. Just the way we will never see, but first of all, we will never see looting as a job, which a lot of people do. But I believe that one day, because of the kind of things people like myself and some other young people are doing with blogging, definitely blogging will be considered a real job. But for me, there are no real jobs. Anything you do that makes you feel comfortable, anything you do that helps in the fulfillment of your dream and passion, if it brings you money, fine. As long as you're doing it and you're making life better and you're being a process of change in your country, in your continent, in the world, you do something real. That's my own opinion.
Why did you start blogging then?
I started blogging because a friend of mine felt that the things I normally say would be better served. People would be better served if people are able to use those things even when I'm not speaking. So which meant that I had to always have my things documented, my thoughts documented. And I started in 2009, 4 years ago today. 4 years ago this month, 15th of February 2009, almost a year, 4 years perfectly, really. And since then, I've not looked back. From starting, obviously, with myself, I reach as much as 500,000 people via Twitter during campaigns, and my blog reached almost the same number in 2012. And apart from the several millions of hits, and we're changing the order of what realness is.
So you're only 28 years old.
Yes, please.
What is it like to be young in Nigeria today? Can you describe?
It depends on what you call young. I don't think I'm young at 28. Actually, when you benchmark, and I like to benchmark myself against the world, I don't think a a 28-year-old in America would say he is young, because people, or a 28-year-old in Berlin, because people in these places really achieve things much earlier. But in Nigeria, to be young has different meanings. The population of young people that are out of jobs are almost 70%, if not more. So to be young in Nigeria is to struggle. To be young in Nigeria is to be looked down upon. But at the same time, there are other young people that are redefining this. They are helping to redefine what it means to be young. Young Nigerians, they are grabbing the bulls by the horn and making change happen. A lot of people now know the likes of Dibanj, Don Jazzy, Wizkid, very young people taking Nigerian music to the world. We have Nigerian writers like Chimamanda Adichie and some other ones taking Nigeria's messages to the world. And young Nigerians are also, there are a lot of unknown young people making real change happen. But you know, in a country where old men are made to lead youth wings of political parties, you see that there is no attention to youth development. There is no attention to growing a youth population that is active and responsible to itself. But our young people just won the African Nations Cup, so maybe that would be a sign of good things to come. So to be young in Nigeria, yes, despair from the past, but there is something to look forward to for tomorrow.
Nigeria could be one of the richest nations there is, but it's not.
Yeah.
Is the youth frustrated with that?
Everybody's frustrated, not just the youth. There are about 112 million poor people in my country, about 70% of the population. That is to say that for every 3 Nigerians you meet, 2 of them are likely to be poor. That's a disaster for a country that has earned hundreds of billions of dollars from petroleum export. For a country that the Prime Minister of Great Britain, David Cameron, said in January of 2013 at the World Economic Forum, that there was a discrepancy of about $800 million in the petrol accounts. That's a lot of money. Nigeria obviously has no business being poor. But when you see how much of our resources is being wasted in an overbloated National Assembly, for instance, being wasted in the management of a presidency that is about the most incompetent in the world, that is being wasted on unnecessary events and frivolities, you would see that things could be better done. You would see that Nigeria as a country has no business being poor. You would see that if Nigeria actually sits down, gets its act together, prosperity would be the norm. And that's why people like myself are there. We're not keeping quiet. I'm proud of other young people in Nigeria not keeping quiet. And I believe that by the time we grow a very strong, active population of citizens, voicing their hope, voicing their fears, voicing their agitations, and organizing rather than agonize, change will happen, and the prosperity that is supposed to be the right and norm in Nigeria will take place, hopefully.
Can you tell us more about the Nigerian Occupy movement in Nigeria?
The Occupy movement was triggered by the president of Nigeria.
How?
By trying to add to the cost of petroleum. Now, petroleum is not just an economic issue in Nigeria. Petroleum is a cultural issue. Petroleum defines everything we do in Nigeria. You would think that I'm saying this because petroleum is Nigeria's biggest export. But our lives revolve around petroleum. Power is on petroleum. Nigeria hardly generates power. Power cuts all over the place. People use petrol to do their own power. People use petrol for their movements. People use petrol. Some 60% of production cost in Nigeria is via either petrol or diesel. So when the president started mooting on increasing the price of petrol, it was pressing on an issue that was always going to trigger something extraordinary. But there was also a connection. In September, the Occupy Wall Street movement started, and on social media, Nigerians were asking, can we really occupy in Nigeria? Is this something that could be done? And different arguments, most of the arguments were that this, of course, would never happen in Nigeria. Nigerians would never occupy. And of course, some others were saying it's possible. I personally had the opportunity of being the first person to officially at a public event say why we should occupy, how we could occupy, and going about it, how to do it. I also, 4 days later after that event in Abuja in October on NN24, Nigeria's first 24-hour cable news station, said we were going to occupy, and I said why we were going to occupy. I of course said that our reasons for occupation was of course not to dislodge the presidency or the government, but to make government see that we have a voice. And I believe that it was going to be the beginning of cementing a process that shows that young people in Nigeria can actually also voice their opinion and their agitations. And voila, no, before the voila, I sent an email across to young people I felt could be very useful in organizing, because they had done some form of organizing when the former president of Nigeria went to Saudi Arabia without formally handing over to the vice president to be acting president. And we got the former vice president to become acting president via some form of protest. So I wrote an email to these guys, and we started planning. We were planning for April when the government said they were looking to do it. And then on the 1st of January 2012, the president did it. It was shocking. It was annoying. It was whatever you could it was evil. It was demonic. People had traveled to their homes for Christmas. Nigerians like to travel to their homes. They had traveled to their homes for Christmas. And they were basically being exploited right there in their different places. Because what it meant was that the cost of living was going to at least double. So if you were spending 10,000 naira on anything, you would be spending 20,000 naira. Let me use euro. If you were spending 50 euro on buying something, you would be spending 100 euros. Which of course also meant that whatever amount of money you're earning as a salary, say if you were earning 50 euros, whatever 50 euros could do before, it's now what 100 euros would do, which meant that half of your income is gone. So of course, on the 2nd of January, we came out in Abuja, we had organized, and the following Monday, organized labor was involved. I moved from Abuja to Lagos, and it was extraordinary. Kano, Abuja, Ibadan, Abeokuta, these are Nigerian cities, Adamawa, Benin, and several other places, some 32 cities across the world, Washington, Finland, cold Finland, Belgium, Ghana, South Africa, New York, Occupy Nigeria, shook the world. And Nigerians made a statement to say that, look, you cannot continue to take us for granted. Some have said it failed, but those were people that expected that Occupy Nigeria was about changing the government. I will show you documents from the emails I sent and my conversation. For me, it was never about changing the government. For me, it was about starting a process that will make young Nigerians to become awakened, to take their issues of governance very, very serious. And if you look at the things we've done since Occupy Nigeria till today, you will see that thing that we started with Occupy Nigeria has been sustained, and in the long run will be very, very critical to the conversation in Nigeria, and knowing that young people in Nigeria, and indeed all Nigerians, cannot be taken for granted when it comes to the running of affairs of the Nigerian nation.
How many people were involved in this movement?
Oh, you cannot begin to quantify, because we're speaking in terms of the millions, and we're speaking across social classes. We had people, Ikoyi is about the most uptown place in Nigeria, even if not in Africa. People came out to occupy Victoria Island. People came out to occupy in Ojota. The numbers were in the millions. You can go to Google and search Occupy Nigeria Ojota. You will see the numbers were in the millions. People came out in London. People came out in Washington. The numbers were extraordinary, and the statement was clear: not business as usual. And in my opinion, that statement still resonates till today.
Did the movement make any achievements?
The movement made achievements, but you want an answer that says this was what we did on that day. But Occupy Nigeria and the ideology behind it, it's a process. It wasn't something that was supposed to achieve something right there and then, because even governance itself is a process. So it was about, first of all, making a statement that we can do this. We can do this, which we did. And then also building an army of active citizens, which we now have. There's a pool of active Nigerian citizens that are now involved in different things simply because we're part of Occupy Nigeria. We've helped to raise over $200,000 for young Nigerians with, you know, different cancer and different terminal diseases, and raise money for them. Recently, it was the Occupy movement in Nigeria that actually helped to get the president's attention to the lead poisoning issue in Bagega, Zamfara State. And now the president, after several months of promise, finally released the funding for that. So Occupy Nigeria has taken different forms in its expression, but it is still there and it is achieving results. But people would rather judge it with the January event, which of course makes them lose the point. But I would rather say that the question that Occupy Nigeria has come to answer is still being answered. And until the question finally gets answered, you don't say it has failed. It's a process.
Would you consider yourself as one leader in this movement? Did it have a leader?
Everybody is a leader. You cannot tell the Occupy Nigeria story without telling the path that I played, the kind of leadership I offered. But it wouldn't have been possible if individual Nigerians that came out did not take leadership into their own hands. So everybody that was part of the movement is a leader, because each person at least called somebody to come out. So we were all leaders. If we are stars, I'm just another. If we were a constellation, I'm just another star in that constellation.
Are you interested in getting involved in politics also?
I'm involved in politics. I'm a media person. I bring issues to the fore. I raise issues. I start debates. So I don't know what you mean by involved in politics. Occupy Nigeria was being involved in politics. I was involved. So yeah, I'm involved in politics, except you want to ask a different question.
But there are voices who want to vote for you in the future, maybe.
Oh yeah, in terms of that, that's partisan politics. There's time for everything. And for me, I want to do things across the world. I want to prove to myself that I'm not just about Nigeria. I'm not just a local champion, like we say in Nigeria. I want to make things happen across the world. Of course, Nigeria will always be important to me. Nigeria will always be primary to me. But I need to show that I can do certain things excellently well by global standards. And after that, who knows? Yeah.
My last question would be, Nigeria has just earned the title Champions of Africa.
Yeah.
Winning the AFCON tournament.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
that was it.
Do you think this is kind of a good sign, maybe,
for
the future of Nigeria?
Of course. Look, we've been through many tough things recently. And the beauty of winning the tournament was not just that we won it, it was the way we won it. Nobody gave us a chance from the beginning. I didn't. Nigerians didn't, because we were in the wilderness of football. Our football had gone dead. It was nothing to write home about. Since 96, when we won the Olympic gold medal, there was really nothing. And we were not expecting anything. We were going to play Cote d'Ivoire. Cote d'Ivoire, on paper at the time, were the best team in Africa, you know, for the past 6 years. And it was supposed to be a whitewash, kind of. And we beat them. We met Mali, ranked 25th in the world. We ranked 52. We did not just beat them, we embarrassed them. It was 4-0, then we relaxed and they scored one, so 4-1. And in the finals, we just made it look respectful. We didn't want to embarrass Burkina Faso. So we just gave them 1-0. And we are champions of Africa. And I think that if the leaders of Nigeria can learn from the Nigerian coach, Steven Keshi, and his boys, and see that when you get results, you don't make enemies, you make friends. Success brings about friends. When the leaders of Nigeria see that it is not about them, it is about the people of Nigeria. When they see that solving the problem of a nation is not solving personal problems, it's solving problems, it's bringing about solutions that affect everyone. When the leaders of Nigeria and the elite see that bad roads in Nigeria doesn't mean to get an SUV, but to fix it so that everybody can enjoy it. That criminals in Nigeria doesn't mean to escape Nigeria and build a house in Dubai or even in Berlin, but to solve the problem and make everybody live in peace. When these leaders see that the prosperity of a nation is better than the prosperity of just individuals and selected individuals, when they see all these things and see that posterity will judge whether they do good or do bad, that the path to greatness is never about the self, but about everyone. When they see that, learning from these super egos, then their names will be written in gold. But for now, a lot of them have their names written in shit. Thank you.
Thank you for being with us.
My pleasure.